It's Running with the Devil on 108.9 The Hawk. Jason Gore in with, man, we've got a great show for you today on The Hawk Afternoons. We're going to be here with you until 6 p.m., but I'm not alone in the studio. Who's here with me?
All right, it's me, Jeff the Angry Man Garlock, of course. How are we doing today, Jason?
Goddamn it, running!
Oh, we do this, hear me one more time!
Do you think that they were just like, all right, David, do what you want to do in there? The other guys just left.
I have a feeling almost every song went that way.
Every song.
The motto of Van Halen at that time was, do what you want to do, David. I'm going for a smoke break.
So Eddie and Alex and Michael Anthony, you have to say his full name. You can't just say Michael.
Because we won't know who you're talking about.
which Michael?
Exactly.
They would lay all the tracks down. Yes. Everything would be perfect. And then they would head on out to the local Sharnies.
Oh, definitely.
And get a meal.
Michael would always say, you know what to order, because he was actually more of the stickler. So he'd stick around, just make sure the levels were right. And then he'd head over to the Sharnies. And then David was just ready to, you know, he just did what he did. And he certainly did what he did on that song.
And that's why they are in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame.
The only reason.
The only reason.
Yes.
When they were nominated, they were like, well, they did that weird shit in the studio that basically made no sense whatsoever.
I guess we got to put them in. There's no other reason. And that's Van Halen for you.
It's either them or Chuck Berry this year. What are we going to do?
Flip a coin.
Oh,
but Van Halen, you know we love you, and we are running with the devil with you.
Yes, we are.
Down here at 108.9 The Hawk.
Man, we're having a great time here at 108.9 The Hawk. Remember, we are your third favorite classic rock station, but we are gunning for number one.
We're going to get there again.
Yes.
At some point.
I mean,
If you have enough faith in classic rock and you have enough faith in The Hawk, then just... help us out a little bit here and just tune in a couple more times than you really would.
And we'll have your traffic report for your drive time home coming up very, very soon. We have a special guest in the studio today that we're going to talk to very, very soon as well. We're very excited about this. Actor Al Pacino in studio. He has a long relationship with Val Verde.
Oh, and I'm excited to talk to him. I walked in and my breath took my breath away. He was wandering around the lobby just pounding coffee in Powerade.
Yeah.
And just already had a wild look on his eyes.
Yeah.
At first I thought Steven Tyler was there because I saw the pile of scarves. And then I thought Johnny Depp. And then I realized it was the Pacino. I hadn't looked at the schedule lately. Ron's kind of stopped sending me the schedule.
Oh, really?
Station manager Ron, of course, you can send me I have my email. I haven't changed it.
Okay.
Still Jeff the Anger Man Garlock at GoDaddy.com. So please send it over there. I go to the library at least once a week to check it. So just let me know. But I was excited. I was excited to see Pacino.
So GoDaddy just lets you use their URL for your email address.
Yeah, I mean, I don't get these computers, but I needed to have one. GoDaddy gave me the option at one point, and I've been running with it ever since.
Almost like you're running with the devil.
Thank you.
Hit me with one more email one more time!
I didn't get the email!
Make sure you check out the attachment!
Also, big news today, Hawk Afternoons this afternoon is brought to you by everybody's favorite restaurant, Sharnies.
No one eats for free at Sharnies.
So whenever you hear the Sharnies jingle, either Jeff or myself have to do a live spot talking about how much we love Sharnies, which I've got to tell you, that is going to be very, very easy.
Do not have to twist our arms to talk about Sharnies. I mean, Sharnies is a wonderful place. It's like you're eating with your family at Sharnies.
It is.
If your family is your angry, wild aunt.
Yes. And that's also kind of the feeling that you get from Sharnies, because Sharnies, of course, was founded in 1934 in Val Verde by Ma Sharnie.
Yeah.
And that is a title, almost like the Pope. That is passed down from different Maws throughout the years.
I'm pretty sure the person running it now is a 22-year-old former plumber.
Yeah.
But we have to call him Ma Sharney.
Ma Sharney.
These are the rules. I don't even understand how he got in the business. The bloodlines of the Sharneys are very confusing, and they wind deep into the history
and they're,
of Valverde.
Yeah, they pretty much are the history of Valverde.
In some ways, it's like some places have the Hatfields, some places have those McCoys.
Right.
We've got the Sharneys.
We've got the Sharneys, and so does America. It is America's number one restaurant, Sharneys. No one eats for free. We'll talk about them coming up, and we'll have Al Pacino on. But first, you know who it is.
Oh.
Kiss on 108.9 The Hawk. Boom!
Let's go to Detroit.
This is right where the fireworks would be going off, Jeff.
Right about here. I mean, Gene's tongue has been out this
whole
time.
1, 2, 3. Firework.
Wow.
Firework.
Just nonstop. And,
oh. 108.9 The Hawk.
Hello, Farmer Dan, down at Shetland Creameries.
And that was the last we heard of him. Hi, I'm Farmer Jim, Farmer Dan's son, down here at Shetland Creameries. For weeks, my father's gone on and on about his missing cattle. How weird. Who would have thunk he'd be the one missing now? And if you happen to have seen him, please, please, please do give us a call. We don't know where he could be hiding. Last thing he said to me while standing over the burning hole in the ground that was Shetland Creameries was, "Vengeance is Farmer Dan's." Well, Dad, I hope wherever you are, you find that vengeance and maybe some peace at Shetland Creameries, where we're definitely closed now.
108.9 The Hawk. Probably one of my favorite bands that
easily
that rhymes with Ram and Jam. It's Ram Jam.
I'm not taking a jam without a ram.
Why would you? Why would you? Seriously.
No, seriously. Why would I?
Seriously, why would you?
I'm asking you a serious question.
But I'm bringing it back to you. What would be the reason?
Okay, I'll give you a reason. Because without the jam, there is no ram, and without the ram, there is no jam.
Oh! Ram jam. That's what you get on 108.9 The Hawk, guys. That was Black Betty Ram Jam. Without the ram, there ain't no jam. And without the jam, why even have the ram?
Thank you.
We're having a great time here at the studio. We're in the Hawk Nest here at Valverde Valley Radio Partners, and it is a very big day for us here on 108.9 The Hawk because we do have a guest in studio with us right now. Ladies and gentlemen, let's just get right to it. One of my all-time favorite actors and yours, Al Pacino.
Oh, wow. Oh, thank you for having me. Thank you for having me on the show. Thank you for letting me swing by to join you, Jason Gore and Jeff the Angry Man. Jeff, normally people are calling me the Angry Man. It's going to take some getting used to swap the mantle over to you, but I should be able
for
to
this,
manage
for this
it.
Segment, you can be it. You are the Angry Man. I am just the lowly Jeff Garlock.
Oh, no. Thank you for having me on the show, boys of the Hawk.
It's really great to have you here, Mr. Pacino. Of course, House of Gucci in theaters right now on digital. I loved the movie. I thought you were fantastic in it.
Thank you. That's good to hear. That's what I like to hear.
Jeff, what did you think of the movie?
You seem fantastic. And I haven't actually seen it yet.
Wow. Oh, don't worry about it. Neither have I. So don't worry about that.
You didn't watch it either.
Nope. Oh, Jason, no. I rarely watch my own pictures. I like to save it all for the camera and not corrupt my own impression of my talent by gazing back onto the screen. But it looks great. I loved working with Ellen Ripley. What a dame. And she really knows her way around the camera.
I've heard it's great work. I mean, so is this a tactic you learned from the actor who played Grandpa on The Munsters? Because he also would not watch his work. He didn't watch one episode of The Munsters. Did he teach you this?
No, I believe it was Harrison Ford on an episode of Late Night with Conan O'Brien who mentioned it, and it stuck with me ever since.
Oh, so this was a late in your career decision.
This, it was late in my career when I figured out a method to the madness. But no, I rarely, I've actually only seen, let me see, five movies. I've seen five movies.
Which ones?
Oh, okay. I've seen the film Looking for Richard. I've seen the film Chinese Coffee. I've seen the film Salome. And I have seen the film Wild Salome. And I have seen the film The Matrix Reloaded.
Didn't even realize you were in The Matrix Reloaded, but I need to catch up on that
series. I was not in The Matrix Reloaded. I went to the theater to see my buddy Jack light up the screen in Anger Management on a fateful May day in 2003, but I showed up 10 minutes late to the theater. The screening had already started, so I instead bought a ticket to see The Matrix Reloaded instead.
Oh, so to clear this up, you've never seen any movies?
No, I have seen five movies.
Oh, you've seen five movies.
Looking for Richard, I have seen Wild Coffee. Okay. I mean, yes. Chinese Coffee. I have seen Salome, Wild Salome,
and
The Matrix Reloaded.
Matrix Reloaded.
Oh, I have to say, I thought it was wild enough that you hadn't even seen your own movies, but only five movies have ever existed. So you've never seen Cruising.
Oh, no, but I remember the experience very fondly.
So if this is the case, and these are all fairly recent movies, Al, if you don't mind me calling you
Sure,
Al.
Sure, please do.
These are all recent movies. So what made you want to get into movies if you hadn't really seen any?
Well, I loved performing. I loved the stage. I loved the words of the bard. And I kept going from there. And then, you know, that's where the money is. That's where the marquees are, that's where the dames are, all splashed upon the silver screen. So that's where I went.
No one eats for free at Charlie's.
Oh, our apologies, Al. If you give us one second here.
No, go ahead. Do your craft.
Charlie's is the sponsor of Hawk Afternoons. Jeff, I'll take this one.
You got it.
Hey, if you go on down to Charney's, make sure you check out their pancake pile. That is 15 pancakes per order, all served fresh. Eat them or Ma will be angry. Another great thing I love down at Charney's, especially for breakfast, is the Charney's steak chunk breakfast. Is it a filet or is it just a random piece of beef? No idea, but it's a chunk and it's for breakfast down at Charney's. Remember, no one eats for free at Charney's.
No one eats for free at Charney's.
Al, we'll hop back into some more of this amazing conversation. I think we're learning things that nobody really has talked to you much about.
Oh, sure. Happy to provide an exclusive peek behind the curtain.
Yeah, we'll hop right back into that curtain. But first, we got to hop right into some Billy Squire.
Whoa. Hope we can hear the squire over my stomach grumbling. Oh.
No one eats for free at Charney's.
Why do I eat at Charney's? The prices.
Yeah, I think I like to eat at Charney's because it's a good meal for a good price.
I eat at Charney's because it's right next to the prison that I work at.
Well, you know, thinking about it, you know, I come to Charney's because I've always been coming to Charney's. And, you know, it's a family tradition. You know, Ma Charney, she's in the back cooking up everything. And she runs a tight ship with a lot of really good foods. You got the buffet. You got the American favorites like the corn dog and the hot dog and the all USA burger. And where else am I going to eat?
Yes, I've been eating at Shawnee's for 4 months now, and it is a delicious meal and a very good price. And the one thing I do like about it is everybody there is paying. Literally, nobody eats for free.
No one eats for free at Shawnee's.
Most hawks eat dead things. This hawk eats classic rock. 108.9, The Hawk.
How, 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 how. How, how. You do it, Al. Do one of those. How,
how, how, how.
That's good. That's good. ZZ Top.
He's the master.
This is why he's the master. ZZ Top on 108.9, The Hawk. Jason Gore, Jeff Garlock. We already have another angry man in here with us today.
Oh, who, me?
You! Man, we are having a great time here on 108.9 The Hawk with our special guest of honor, Al Pacino. Al, I do want to tell you one very exciting thing for Val Verde, and we know you have a rich history with Val Verde, but the Val Verde $1 Theater is reopening, and we finally get the premiere of Devil's Advocate.
Oh, wow. Oh, that's exciting. Oh, that was me. That's me and Chris Reeves, and who else? Who else is in that
Well,
picture?
It's you. It's Keanu.
Keanu, the Superman? No, you're thinking of Chris Reeves.
No, Chris Reeves. Chris Reeves was Superman. Keanu is the Matrix man. He's Neo.
Oh, good kid. Good kid. Good kid. I like
Did you realize that when you were watching Matrix Reloaded that you had act with him?
I couldn't believe he was on the screen. I was not familiar with the mythology of the world, so I was pleasantly surprised to see that little baby-faced boy up there just lighting up the screen, tearing up the celluloid.
Another thing about The Matrix Reloaded and you watching it, you hadn't seen the previous film. So you went in, this was your entry point into The Matrix.
No, it really began in media res for old Al Pacino. But I caught up pretty quick. Thankfully, the movie is not terribly complicated and certainly does not feature reams of dialogue about any kind of diving into any deep sections of the world, so I could sort of use my human intuition to put it all together.
Oh, starting to feel like you might have not even. Are you sure you saw Matrix Reloaded? Was there a giant cave rave?
100% positive. The movie begins. Green screen. Digital rain falls from the ceiling to the floor. The words "The Matrix" zoom towards you. Then. Little lettery numbers switch over to Reloaded. So I am, it made quite an impression on me. So I am 100% positive that that's the one that I saw.
All right.
But I hope the folks at Val Verde really enjoy The Devil's Advocate. We had a lot of fun making it several years ago. So I can only hope that you'll have a lot of fun watching it.
And I'm excited because I, you know, my movie going experience, I really can only afford the dollar theater that we have there. So I was so happy that it finally opens, and it does take a while for movies to get here, but when it does, it is like a Hollywood premiere.
Yeah, and I mean Jeff's right because I mean we work in radio. Everybody knows there's no money in radio, so this is already kind of a stretch on our budget, but it's a huge deal. Everybody's so excited. The Devil's Advocate finally opening up. Are you here for the premiere? Because I know
I will be strutting my way up and down that red carpet, soaking in the light of the popping flash bulbs as all the stars are out for the second premiere of The Devil's Advocate. So very excited. No, don't worry. I would not miss it for the world.
Oh, that's so cool. That's so cool. That's so cool. Because Craig T. Nelson's in town, too. Have you guys spoken?
Not in years, Craig. Yeah. Oh, baby Craig.
The coach.
Baby Craig. Coach
himself.
Oh, you call him baby. You call him baby coach.
I call him baby coach. I call everybody baby coach. So it's only a happy coincidence that it sort of makes slightly more sense to name him that nickname.
Oh, I can't, now I'm just picturing a wonderful world if we could go down to the premiere and we have Al Pacino.
Oh, God.
Craig T. Nelson.
Oh, God.
The
baby
guy
coach.
Who played Dauber.
Hey, good reason they call Val Verde Little Hollywood.
You know what?
They do.
They do. We've got the studios. We've got Verde Studios out on Highway 58.
The Dream Factory.
And we've got that walk of shame in front of the Sharnies.
We do.
We got all the squares out there. Just the squares with all the names of the most fabulous people who have visited Val Verde. One day I hope we make it on there.
Oh,
one
God. Day I hope we make it on. That would be the best.
More money for free at Charney.
Jeff, I think it's your turn.
Sharnies, say, you might want to go down to Sharnies this week because they have got that all-you-can-eat Sharnies buffet. Of course, that all-you-can-eat Sharnies buffet, you get are allowed two plates. There are five choices, and you get one choice. So make sure you choose right because you have to finish everything on your plate. And if you get in there this week, don't forget about that Jell-O fountain. That Jell-O fountain, it is full of chunks. There's a lot of fruit. It is a rainbow of Jell-O. It's a little bit more liquid than you want. But again, take all you want, but eat all you take. But make sure you definitely eat it, or my Sharnie is coming for you.
Oh, she will.
No one eats for free at Sharnie's.
We'll be back with more Al Pacino, but first,
we won't get fooled again. I want to wait for you in the Hawk.
I almost feel like I could do weather here.
It does feel, you I mean, you want to pump one out there? Yeah, okay. Go for it.
Hey, Valverde, you were looking at temperatures of 58 throughout the afternoon. If you're heading on down to Hog Street, it's going to be 85 only on Hog Street. So watch out for that. That is quite the difference in temperature. 108.9 The Hog.
Gotta get a hot dog? Well, then come on down to Fletchy's, Valverde's only New England-style hot dog stand. And of course, you're gonna want to cover your hot dog in our hot, spicy relish. It's world famous. And I know what you're all saying. That relish, it's not so good no more. Well, you know what I say to that? Screw you. I know it and you know it. But hey, nostalgia always lets you down. We've been making Fletchy's famous relish since the beginning, and it never tasted good. But I didn't want to cross Mama, and you don't want to cross me. So just eat the goddamn relish, all right? I know that it's mostly peppers. It is disgusting. And I'm not talking good peppers. I'm talking green peppers with just the hot part of a jalapeno. It's bad. But you will eat it because it's Fletchy's. We hate our relish, too.
108.9, The Hawk.
Taking it easy, Valverde, because we are on a slow ride and our drivers are fog hat. All right, here on 108.9, The Hawk. Hey, Jason, I got a question I got to ask you there.
Hey, Jeff, I potentially have an answer there for you.
Oh, thank goodness. Do they change the words when they break it down? They stop saying slow ride and they start saying slow and then ride.
Right.
Do I hear a take it sleazy in there at one point?
Take it sleazy! I think they do put that in there. It was probably, you know, bands have inside jokes.
Yeah.
I don't know if you know out there, all of your 108.9 The Hawk listeners, bands have inside jokes and they like to put them in the songs.
Most of your favorite classic rock songs are really just mostly inside jokes from a bunch of bros.
Right, like the bunch of bros, like the broiest dudes, the guys from The Who, big bros.
Jesus, the Ox. I mean, have a Bob O'Reilly.
Yeah,
that's just something you'd call Keith Moon. you can't even get into what it means, but it is filthy.
It is filthy. But I mean, The Who, as an example, you know, one of their big jokes was, you know, they would say, "Who the fuck are you?" And then, so of course, Daltrey did it in the song. And inside jokes, guys.
Inside they are all jokes.
Over classic rock. And
BG's, I started a joke. I mean, that one, you should hear the demo. Robin really then tells a joke.
It was the Aristocrats.
Yeah, it is a long, very long song, and it is filthy. And once again, because it's Robin Gibbs, it somehow involves drawing penises all over everything.
And then at the end of I Started a Joke by the Bee Gees, if you crank it up very, very loud, like max out your system, you'll hear Robin Gibb go, "The Aristocrats."
It will make you chuckle and make you laugh, and it you really feel like will. You're part of the Bee Gees team when you get there. But you might blow out your speakers, so watch out for it.
You might blow them out. You might blow them out. Hey, there's one team I'm very happy to be on today, and that is Team Pacino.
Oh. Still here. Not going anywhere.
Still here. Thank you so much for hanging around. So what are you going to get into while you're in Valverde?
Well, you know, as I, as we have discussed, I have a storied and difficult history with the Valverde area. somewhat painful to return to the scene of one of my deepest shames. So it took a lot of strength and character to come back. But I managed to swallow my pride and return for a little trip down memory lane.
Well, this might be... Jeff, I don't know if I'm speaking for you, but I don't know if I know what this shame is.
You don't know the story.
Yeah. No, it feels like you're insinuating we all know what the story is.
Yeah.
But I think this might be a truly secret shame.
I'm sorry. Sometimes I confuse my memories for the memories of the human race. So, the year is 1977. Do you recall?
I definitely remember. What a year.
It was
what a year.
And what a year. And I had booked a part at the Shakespearean Rep of Val Verde, or SERV for short, where they were performing Richard III, one of my favorite plays, one of the great characters of the stage. I spent the whole summer learning the part in and out, and took the train up to Valverde to tread the boards. And I, even though I was, you know, already a big-time guy, my first and greatest love is the theater. And to return to it, oh, wow, just makes me blush and beam. But when I returned, unfortunately, there was a miscommunication where they were doing Richard the Second, not Richard the Third. A small but crucial one single eye, but really makes a big difference when you've spent the entire summer learning the wrong king. The wrong king. I learned the wrong king, boys. I didn't do the correct king.
I get that. I mean, the interesting part is, I mean, of course, we've got such a great summer stock series here at Val Verde, one of the best in the country. All the greats come through here. But I think, Jason, I don't know if you're feeling it, but he started telling that story, and I started remembering it word for word.
I remember that, and I remember Tony Grant ran the Shakespeare Company in Verde at that point in time, didn't he? Okay.
Tony.
Okay, I think I'm saying a name that clearly resonates with Mr. Pacino.
You're making me hum. Jason, you're making me hum in recognition.
I know.
I'm humming.
Good.
I'm about to hum, Jason.
So my
wait. I think I'm worried, though. I feel like I'm about to hum. I'm feeling like I remember Tony Grant, like this shared mind he was speaking about. Do we have a shared mind with Pacino? Do we?
Well, you mean that my memories, the intimation I made that my memory might be the memory of the human race, that could be not some delusional fantasy, but the real reality that we're living. Are you telling me that reality as we know it is not exactly what it seems to be?
I mean, I don't want to say I'm telling you that, but maybe you're telling me that, but maybe I'm telling you, and you and I know the same things, much like you and me, Jason, know the same things, and it was just an aside, but it feels like...
I feel it.
I feel
it's like I'm tapped into something bigger.
Right.
And it's I know who did Pacino wrong.
I did.
I know who did it. Jeff.
Are you... Jason, are you seeing a rain of green binary numbers in front of you right now?
But who do you know who you see in front of you, Jeff? There's only one man who pulled this shit on Pacino.
Could it be the monster himself?
Wisp Turlington.
Oh my goodness.
Oh, you're making me hum, Jason.
He's here in the building.
Oh no.
Should I?
I mean, is this gonna be are we gonna have a fixing of the problem? Are we gonna find did you find the tear in this Pacino matrix that we could maybe solve.
I think I may have found the tear. Al, can you stick around and we resolve this?
I would love to resolve this psychic tear.
Me too. Oh no, I'm starting to sound like Pacino. Please, we got to get whispering here.
By all means, go ahead.
But before we go, we do have to do this. Hey, one other thing, Mr. Pacino.
Sure.
Ma Sharni actually called in and asked if you could do this one.
And how is Ma?
Ma's great.
How's Ma doing?
This is Ma the Eighth.
Ma the Eighth, though, of course it is.
The sort 22-year-old plumber, of course, who is now Ma, the runs the Sharni's empire.
Ma the Eighth. So there are several different, you know, iterations of Ma. Is that what you're telling me?
Right, yes. Right. It's almost like the Pope. So it gets passed on. You have to elect.
So what you're telling me is...
And you are passed on the Sharni hat. It's just made out of Salisbury steak.
Wait, so what you're telling me is that the Ma is older than you know. I prefer counting from the emergence of one integral anomaly to the emergence of the next, in which case that this is the eighth Ma. There are only two possible explanations. Either no one told me or no one knows. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, there you go. That's your Sharni's breakdown on 108.9 The Hawk. Remember, Sharni's, no one eats for free. We'll be back with Al Pacino and Jeff. I hate to say it.
Oh my God.
Wish Turlington. It's coming up next, but right now it's the Stones on The Hawk.
The movies are back at Valverde Dollar Cinemadrome, Valverde's premier dollar theater, where the movies may be older, but they are definitely cheaper. I'm Tom Chenky, the owner of the theater, and I want to open the red curtain and pull up the velvet rope and invite you to come see a flick with me. Yes, we were closed for quite a long time due to that rat problem, and then that Rat King problem. And then I just got tired of running a theater. Life is tough. But the magic of the movies couldn't keep me and you away, so come on out to our opening premiere gala event for The Devil's Advocate. You'll all be screaming, "I'm the devil!" Just like Pacino, and just like it's 1997. Maybe even with Pacino? That's all I can say. And we also have plenty of hit movies on the horizon. From Predator 2 to Van Helsing, we have all of the movies you wanted to see at some point in your life. We even have Licorice Pizza on our schedule 6 years from now. And I even figured out how to change the syrup on the RC Cola dispenser so it isn't just brown seltzer. So come on down to the Valverde Dollar Cinemadrome, where they might be old, but they are still legally movies.
Hey, I'm Zane from the local band Fister, and you're listening to 108.9 The Hawk. Hell yeah, man. Hell yeah. Cream, White Room on 108.9 The Hawk. Breaking our no Clapton rule, but we do not have a no Jack Bruce or Ginger Baker rule.
We don't. We were close with Ginger once.
We
Ginger,
were.
He pushed it a lot.
You pushed it, Ginger.
Clapton, you're still the fucking worst.
You're still the worst, Eric Clapton. It's Jason Gore on 108.9 The Hawk. It's Jeff Garlock on 108.9 The Hawk. It's Al Pacino on 108.9 The Hawk. And I'm going to pass the mic over because I think a reckoning is about to happen. Maybe some healing is about to happen. And here we go. Let me hand this over to...
Hello, Wisp.
Okay, let me get this damn thing here.
All right.
Okay, Wisp
Turlington.
You've
been doing radio for 40 years. You don't know how to handle a freaking microphone? Come
Who
on.
Is that? Greg?
No, Jeff, the angry man. I mean, nope, sorry. Today I am just simply Jeff Garlock.
Wait, you lost the angry man?
No.
I didn't.
Oh, who is the angry man.
Thanks. Who is that?
Are you trying to out-whisper me?
I know that voice.
Are you trying to out-whisper me right now?
Are you trying to out-whisper me?
I can out-whisper with the best of them.
I'm you Wisp. It's literally in my name.
I am a winner
Pacino.
Of the Academy Award.
Pacino.
All right, gentlemen. I have to be the moderator here. We could have a...
So it was 1977.
Oh, my God.
That was the year.
Grant comes up to me and he's like, "We're doing the Shakespeare shit."
And first off, I say nobody likes Shakespeare anymore.
Oh, that makes me so mad to have anybody say that. You wouldn't, but everybody likes Shakespeare. You're the greatest playwright of all time.
So what happened was, there was a play. I believe you thought you were doing Richard the Second?
I was doing Richard the Third.
It was the reverse of that.
Play Richard the Second, a far less superior play. I don't know what the programming decision was there, but that's for another time.
Well, so I find out that Pacino's on a train coming up from Slathersburg. And I turn to Grant and I say, hey, I wrote a piece of shit and it's called Richard the Second. It's about a guy named Dick. He just does stuff on the street, dirty stuff, nasty stuff. Nobody likes to see it. Almost like a pervert. You know those guys you see kind of grabbing at themselves on the Valverde train?
Of course, we got too many of those guys. Wait, well, hold on a second. Wisp, you wrote the play.
I wrote Richard the Second.
So you backtracked on one of the most famous playwrights and authors ever, William Shakespeare, and wrote your own version. All right, cool.
Why Wisp Turlington? Why would I? If it's going to be good, it might as well come from me.
You're right. I would never put it past a prick like you. So you wrote some sort of version of The Panic at Needle Park, but in Richard the Second?
Jeff,
so
Richard, you could not fathom my disappointment when I learned what was going on.
So he gets off the train, and I'm like, Al, he's crying. He's got tears coming down his face. I remember.
Tears pouring down my face.
Because he was already in character as Richard III, because everyone knows Richard III, famous crier.
Famous, the one attribute that is the most famous thing about Richard III is he's an easy cry.
I don't even know much about Shakespeare. The one thing I know, Richard III, real crybaby.
When they do it at the National Theater in London, it's like, get ready to cry with Richard III. And they say that because they know Richard III is going to be crying. So Al gets off this fucking train. And I'm like, new pages, Pacino. And I toss him over to him. They blow under the train. So Pacino's scrambling around. On his knees. Grabbing pen. He's like, what is this shit? I'm like, read it. There were no other characters. It's just Richard II. And it's a man wandering around talking about things in Valverde. Things he knows. And he makes fun of the Godfather for most of the...
You do that? It feels like you were just screwing with Pacino at this point. Like, why do you feel you need the torture, Mr. Pacino?
Very mocked. I did not feel like my accomplishments were being given the appropriate weight.
Let me see if I still have a copy of this here.
Oh, God. No, not again.
Of course you do. Why are you torturing him?
Okay, here we go. Lights up. Richard II. Hey, my name's Richard. It's Valverde. And today's a day when I'm not gonna touch myself. Wanna know why? I'm so angry about that piece of shit, The Godfather, in theaters now. Have you seen this Al Pacino motherfucker? Ho, ho, ho. What a fraud. Then I walk for about half a page. I turn around and said, he's not a good actor. Blackout.
Okay. So I was about to say, Wisp, I'm going to stop you right there. And then you stopped yourself.
Blackout.
So not only did you bring Al Pacino back to Valverde.
Lights up.
Oh, there's more.
Lights up. It's a whole new day. And Richard II says, it's a second day for me. I don't think I'm going to touch myself today. But I am going to talk a little bit about The Godfather.
Okay, I'm going to cut you off here, Wisp. I'm sorry. This really seems like you just had beef with Pacino.
Jeff,
cut you off.
Jeff Garlock.
I apologize. Yes.
Something you might not understand from this reading is, most plays have two acts, first act, second act. Most Shakespearean plays have five acts, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. this particular play, what you just heard, repeats 38 times as the curtain goes up and down over and over again. It is a torturous experience to observe or to perform, like you wouldn't believe.
Lights up.
Oh my God.
Oh my God, again.
Richard II. Oh, another day. God gave me another day on Earth. And I think with this day, I'm not going to touch myself on the train. But I am going to think about Al Pacino as an actor.
Jesus Christ. It happens over and over.
It's repetitive, too. I'm not going to lie.
I started to get a sense of deja vu as the same thing played out over and over again. Like I had no control over my reality.
The crazy part, though, is because I'm feeling that same sense of deja vu, and I'm feeling it too.
Lights up. Richard II gets out of bed. Oh, God, I'm Richard II. At least I'm a better actor than that Al Pacino guy. I think I will touch myself on the Valverde train today while thinking about how better an actor I am than that Al Pacino, who should remember in 1972, he stepped in front of Wisp Turlington while he was talking to a wonderful woman by the name of Sally Bays.
Is that, Wisp, is that what this is about?
Working on Sally Bays all night long, and all it took was for Al Pacino to pop right in front of him.
That's what this is about.
And she's like,
you petty, petty man.
And he says, the pettiest man that has ever existed. Oh. Every single time he manipulates the world and it gets smaller and smaller. Oh. How he has been aggrieved. And now I feel like you tore a hole into the Pacino reality all because of Sally Bays. monster.
This is 1972. So I can imagine I slid in front of you and said something like, "Hey, I'm Al Pacino. Let's go over there and talk about something else, right?" Is that what I sounded like? Is that what I sounded like?
That's exactly what you sounded like. What happened. I had been talking to Sally for weeks. Weeks. She was finally interested in a radio DJ. And you slip in and you take her away. That was the woman I was supposed to marry. And you slip in with your Pacino charm, and you're just too damn good of an actor. And it hurt.
He is Pacino.
And it hurt. So I figured out a way to rip a hole in your fabric of time. Do you think anybody here remembers Godfather 8? But you filmed it.
8 Godfathers?
There were for Al Pacino.
I have this feeling like I'm doing things again and again. That's why I've done multiple film adaptations of Salome that I've directed myself. That's why I've done several HBO movies with Barry Levinson where I play at some sort of despicable guy. I knew this was happening. I knew this was happening again and again, but I couldn't put my finger on it. That there was something wrong with my reality.
I have to say, Mr. Pacino, this really does make a good explanation for a lot of your career choices. I mean, don't get me wrong. You are very, very funny in your segment of Jack and Jill.
That's the one that I did allow to slip through.
Oh, that's the only time I've been happy for 20 years.
Oh, well, I mean, it made me happy. I have to say, it's a very humorous part watching you dance to about Dunkachinos.
All right, hold on, fellas.
No one eats for free at Charney's.
Charney's, it's on every road. A buffet on every road was Ma Charney's motto for years until it turned into no one eats for free because Ma Charney had so many family members, but they all came to Charney's. I want to say it was Ma the Fourth that had all of her family members come to Charney's and say, "Please, Ma, It's a dust bowl. It's a dust storm. You got to give us something free to eat. And Ma looked down at them and said, no one eats for free at Sharnie's. And if you're going down to Sharnie's right now, why don't you take advantage of their make your own goddamn omelet? That's right. You think you can do this better? Well, then hop behind the griddle and fucking show them. There are toppings, but they rotate every single day. It could just be raisins and ham today. You never know at Sharnie's, where no one eats for free.
No one eats for free at Sharnie's.
Blackout.
I have to say, Wisp, I'm sitting here just stunned, scared, a little hungry because I'm thinking about Sharnie's. I'm thinking about that cold, fatty prime rib station where you have to really suck on the fat there. But also, you mentioned, though, that about Ma Sharnie and the four of them and the legacy, much like Richard III, I is this all part of the Pacino Matrix? Sharnie's?
Sharnie's is very, very real, Keith. You know
all right.
it.
All right.
I know it.
I have to step
I just worry. I just want to make sure. I was just getting a little worried. I don't know what reality is anymore. I don't know if I'm eating a really tough, disgusting steak at Sharnie's, if I'm just like Pantalones or not. But
Fellas, shut the fuck up for a second.
Okay.
I'm a bigger man now. I got the Wisp Turlington show back.
That is true.
I got Rock Nights back.
Too many
I do
shows.
Vinyl Winery.
God damn it, took my slot.
That is three shows I'm getting paid a lot of money to do.
Salt in my wounds.
I no longer need this beef.
Can I speak up, Wisp?
Please.
I too am a bigger man than I used to be. Bigger and better. My deliveries are bigger. My hair is bigger than it used to be. And my heart and capacity for forgiveness is bigger as well. I'm like the Grinch. My heart has grown three sizes. And I have to read something for you that I've composed in my head just now.
Okay. I'd like that.
It is a play entitled Richard III. Richard steps onto the stage. Lights up, curtains up. Hi, my name is Richard III. And although today is a day when I'm not going to touch myself, I hope it is a day that I can reach out and touch the man that I harmed by my actions a long, long time ago, when I, with my high, reedy, nasal, sexy voice, stepped in between him and the woman he loves, unknowingly consigning myself to hell in a virtual reality of my own making in some ways, but in more ways of your making, that I deeply regret my actions. And if I could go back, I would say in my high, reedy, nasally, sexy voice, hey, this is my friend Wisp, and you should talk to him. Blackout.
Are you okay? Is that Wisp crying?
Are you okay?
That is the sound of me crying.
I thought so. I thought only a monster like you would cry like that.
Pacino, I release you. Every movie from now on.
Now forth
shall be real.
It's Shakespeare speak.
Every movie from now forth.
What a relief.
Wow.
Shall be real.
Wow. To be freed from the shackles of the simulacrum is deeply meaningful. Thank you, Wisp.
Wisp,
thank
does
you.
This mean we're going to be getting a Jack and Jill 2?
If you dream it, you can believe it.
Oh, that'll be the sixth wow. movie I ever see.
Wow. Wow. Ladies and gentlemen, I mean, I hesitate to say this about Wisp.
Wow, what did you guys do to Wisp? He just slunked out of here. Is that a word? Slunk?
He was slunking. Did he blow your eardrums out with his crying noises?
He patted my back. He's never touched me.
Ew. And wow. All at the same time.
Yeah. Well, I mean, he's never, like, I've never gotten a handshake or anything. Get your mind out of the gutter.
I'm sorry. I just listened to 38 acts of Wisp talking about Al Pacino jerking off as Richard II.
But oh my God! Did he act out Richard II?
He did a he's the one who wrote it.
What?
I know.
Do you know how many times I saw that in high school?
Oh,
I didn't want to ride the Val Verde train for a very long time.
So every man looked filthy. I thought every man was going to start. And if they started talking about The Godfather, oh, get out of there.
Wow.
Yeah. You've missed something. I mean, my...
You've missed a lot, Jason.
I really have.
Like, wow, you take one.
I go to
the
John for like, 15 minutes and...
Welcome to Classic Rock Rules. Try not to go to the John ever.
That's
you
really
will
the
miss
rule.
Out.
That These is really the rule. Hey, we've had a great time here today on Hawk Afternoons with our special guest, Al Pacino. I hope this was a very therapeutic, wonderful experience for
Jason,
you.
You have no idea. I thought I was going to plug my new film, House of Gucci, and now here I am with a new lease on life, so I can't thank you both enough, Hawk Boys. Jeff, I would like to officially, as a token of my appreciation, bequeath the nickname The Angry Man back to you.
Wow.
I bow down to you, sir, and
big
for
moments.
One, I am excited to see your filmography going on.
You
glad to see
and
Scent
me
of a Woman
both.
2 will not be happening. Thank you. Just a beautiful, beautiful day, Mr.
Beautiful
Pacino.
Day. It seems like I missed out on a lot, but it is great.
I'll catch you up.
Catch me up. Catch me up. It has been great having you on here.
Thank you for having me, boys.
One last time, Jeff, if you want to take this one.
No one eats for free at Sharnie's.
Sharnie's, where the ketchup isn't real and it hardly tastes like ketchup, but make sure you put it on everything or you'll piss off Ma Sharnie. Trust us, Ma Sharnie. Don't fuck with her.
No one eats for free at Charney's.
Well, that's been 108.9 The Hawk, and we will see you next time. Once again, thank you to our guest, Al Pacino. Wow. We're getting the stars here, Jeff.
Yeah, I am feeling good after this episode.
You know what I feel like?
I got a feeling.
Oh, you do. Feel like making love. 108.9 The Hawk.
Baby, when I think about you,
Darling. Darling,
I don't live without you.
Pacino, harmonize.
Ah.
108.9 The Hawk. See ya.
Goodbye.